Okay.
Yeah, I maybe forget it. Anyway, thanks for that talk, Halfdan. Excellent. And let me start with a similar apology. I'm not a clinician, so I must apologise for the weakness of my clinical background and lack of medical facts in this talk. This is a purely philosophical argument from a philosopher. And so we've heard over the last couple of days quite a few things being said about evidence-based medicine and weaknesses of randomized controlled trials and so on. But I hope that this talk is going to offer something that you haven't heard before, unless you've heard me give this talk before, which I know at least two people have. Or maybe you read the paper that it's based upon, so that's another possibility. But it's a type of argument raising questions about evidence-based policy, a type of argument that I don't know the whole literature about evidence-based medicine, nobody possibly could because it's too vast, but it's a type of argument that I've not seen before. And this is based on work that I've done with the family over the last couple of years. So what I've tried to do then, to make it clear that it's not one of the usual sorts of objections people raise, is separate what I'm calling an ontological component from a policy component. Because this is an argument that's concerning evidence-based policy. So the ontological component in evidence-based medicine, I'm going to say, is the scientific methodology employing randomized controlled trials. It's a view that this is the best way to discover causal connections in medicine or other contexts, such as for social policy. It's the idea that this kind of method, this kind of experiment, is the best way to reveal which intervention is going to be the most effective, which intervention produces the greatest net benefit, for instance. But separate from that, there is also a policy component which would concern the integration of such evidence, evidence that's come out of the ontological component, integrate it into policy, and in the case that's concerned us over the last 2 days, the way that those policies are sort of realised and made concrete is in guidelines. And so the policy component is a recommendation of the intervention that's been shown to be most effective as defined under the ontological component, so randomised controlled trials. And the policy component, as far as I can see, I think is akin to a form of rule utilitarianism. So this is what I'm saying, I think it's a new kind of objection to my knowledge. Because it's using analogical reasoning, I'm going to point out an obvious weakness in rule utilitarianism and say that it applies to evidence-based policy. So, in order to do this and show that I'm not just raising the old objections that people have been talking about, let me just assume what may be impossible. Let me just assume that we have a perfectly conducted set of randomized controlled trials. Let's assume nothing's gone wrong, and there's the sorts of objections people know. We've all heard stories about how easy it is to corrupt RCTs. All sorts of bias. Let me just abstract completely away from that debate and let's just assume everything's been perfect. And I'm doing that just to show that even if that were the case, it doesn't mean that we have to just meekly accept the policy or guideline, because there is still a further phase. The further phase is required, of course, because policy and guidelines, we are talking about normative matters. We're talking about what we should do. What I'm calling the ontological component, again, if everything has gone right, is about discovery of facts, discovery of the way the world works. But we're saying that there's still a further decision to be made about what to do. Now, I'm comparing evidence-based medicine to rural utilitarianism because what it seems that we've aimed for is a policy, a decision to adopt the policy that is has been proven to benefit the most or produce most benefit if adopted as a single policy. That qualification is going to turn out to be crucial. So the idea is, if we have to have a single policy that applies universally, why not adopt the policy that has been shown to produce most benefit? That sort of thing's going on. However, there is an objection to rural utilitarianism that's been discussed in philosophy. Those who do moral philosophy have noticed that there's a big problem with it, which is that it breaks down. Because if someone is a utility maximizer, this is somebody who's seeking the course of action that's believed to produce the most benefit, then there will always be circumstances in which they can see that even more benefit can be found through ignoring the rule in the cases where there's good reason to believe there's no benefit to be found in following the rule. So this is an objection that comes from Jack Smart and Bernard Williams, who said similar things. So I've got a couple of quotations on the handout. I'll just read the second one, Bernard Williams. Whatever the general utility of having a certain rule, if one has actually reached the point of seeing that the utility of breaking it on a certain occasion is greater than that of following it, then surely it would be pure irrationality not to break it. And Jack Smart says, if you end up following it in those circumstances, then he says it's a form of rule worship, just worshipping the rule. So it's like saying, I'm going to stick to the rule, even if I've got good reason to think doing so will produce no benefit in the case of something. So I hope you immediately can see how this objection to rule utilitarianism transfers over to evidence-based medicine. If we're just going to stick to the guideline, to the rule, even if we have reason to believe it's not going to benefit the patient sat before the clinician, then that's a form of rule worship, and it's irrational if you're a utility maximizer. And Williams and Smart both say that effectively rule utilitarianism will always collapse into act utilitarianism. Act utilitarianism is just where you consider the individual case in front of you and what would produce most benefit for this particular case. Okay, so let's just think a bit more about what happens when this is applied, or the way in which evidence-based medicine describes it. Well, suppose our clinician, again, we're going to accept that the RCT evidence is all correct, and the clinician knows the guidance and so on. It seems that there could be some circumstances in which they have got good reason to doubt utility is produced from following the rule. And the case I've cited is the one Tricia already mentioned yesterday. Suppose someone has just fallen into a group for which a guideline applies, but perhaps they're atypical or marginal for that group. So as Trish told us, it was on her 55th birthday, she suddenly fell into a different subgroup, and she was supposed to have a certain guideline applied to her treatment. Well, it seems in such a case, a clinician knowing this has got no option but to prescribe the intervention pointlessly, a as they believe it to be, or make no prescription at all. So if we can see that all patients are different, and perhaps that there's some form of medical uniqueness, then strict rules are bound to produce a less than optimum outcome. Whereas, one thing I think we've got to accept is that there are other approaches possible. Another world is possible, as I heard somebody say recently. We shouldn't just automatically assume that a kind of rule utilitarian approach is the only approach that makes any philosophical sense. And I will go on to an alternative. But before I do that, and just because I am a philosopher, let me now try to encapsulate everything I just said in the form of a rigorous argument. That's what philosophers do, don't they? And because we have to think about what. So how have we got to that position? How does this kind of objection apply? It seems to me that if you accept three premises, then it shows the argument is going to apply. So here's the explicit argument. So if we accept the following three claims, then the objection from rule utilitarianism is going to apply. First, assume that the intervention to be adopted is the one that statistically is shown to benefit the most. So this, I'm taking this as the core definitive of the idea of evidence-based policy. But then two, we accept that there is individual variation. And of course this shouldn't be controversial. I mean, this is even accepted in evidence-based medicine, and it's why we perform randomization. Because we accept there is difference, perhaps even uniqueness. Each individual is unique. And third, let us accept that there's no single intervention that is better for everyone or makes everyone better. Now, this is admittedly a contingent premise. There's no reason why this has to be true, but it does seem to be true as a matter of fact. Unless you can point out to me some RCT that's been shown that 100% of the treatment group had benefit from the treatment. And as far as I know, that's not the case. So it seems that once you accept these three assumptions, the objection follows. And what I'm going to say is, there's nothing we can do about two or three. So they're both contingent truths, but nothing you can do. It's not as if we can suddenly intervene to stamp out medical uniqueness. I can imagine what that would be. It sounds terrible. So there's nothing we can do about two. As I said, three, well, if we did sometimes find an RCT that was uncontroversially benefiting everyone, then it would escape this objection, but that's not. So it seems that the first premise is the only one that we have the power to reject. We don't have to go for the intervention that statistically benefits the most. Now you might be sitting there thinking, well, what else could you possibly do? Doesn't it make sense to adopt the policy that's been proven to produce most benefit? Well, that's where a clause I mentioned earlier is important. It's only the policy that's been shown to produce most benefit if a single policy for everyone has to be adopted. So if, for whatever reason, we knew that we had to adopt a single policy for everyone, we had to treat everyone the same, then perhaps it would be more attractive to say, well, then adopt the policy that produces most benefit. But thinking purely philosophically, there's no reason why we have to be rule utilitarians. So what else could there be? Well, even some utilitarians have realised that it's deeply problematic. So Brad Hooker, who is a rule utilitarian, has seen the sorts of problems that it raises, and he's tried to mitigate rule utilitarianism. But I think in a way that goes so against the spirit of rule utilitarianism that it's hardly a defense of it. It seems more like reasons why it's not going to hold. Now, I've put his attempt to moderate the rules, put them on the handout, and maybe you can see how these clearly could apply to in the case of medicine. So he said a rule shouldn't tell you what you should do, only what you can do. Seems to be weakening it quite a bit. You should be sensitive in application of the rule. Well, I agree with that, but then that's kind of saying you should be free to ignore the rule if you think there's good reason. He says there can be hard cases where two rules conflict. So clearly this could happen in a medical situation if you have two guidelines. One saying, if you work out the consequences and realise, well, one saying do A, the other saying do not A. And that could clearly occur in cases of multimorbidity, because what's a treatment for one may be inapplicable in another case. He said rules can include sub-rules about when you should break them. For example, if disaster would result from adhering to them. And then he says the best argument for rule utilitarianism is not that it maximises the good, but it makes sense of our moral intuitions. Okay, so is that saying that we should follow moral intuitions rather than really follow rules? Okay, so what's the alternative? Well, in the theory of causation that Ron and I have worked on, to cut to the chase, it's consistent with a position that's known as causal singularism. And this is the idea that there needn't be a general rule. There needn't be a sort of general law of nature, which every case of causation is an instance of. So it's accepting that each causal situation could be unique. And indeed, there is in moral philosophy a correlate to this called moral particularism. And this allows that the moral considerations in each situation, it could be a unique set of circumstances, and you need judgment to think it through. One of the attractions of moral particularism, there's a couple of attractions, so I'll tell you that. One of them is that it seems unlikely that you can have moral rules that apply to every single situation. So if there was an absolute rule, you should never tell a lie, I think there are some situations where it is okay to tell a lie. In fact, Plato in the Republic offered as an example somebody who, somebody who's gone mad and then knocks on your door and says, have you seen so and so? I want to go and kill them. There you can lie and say, no, you have no idea where they are. Okay, so it's not hard to think of examples like that. But another reason behind moral particularism is, again, absolute rules could come into conflict. There could be cases where if there's an absolute rule to be kind and an absolute rule to tell the truth, I'm sure you can imagine cases where those two rules would come into conflict. So moral particularism suggesting that make individual decisions based on the particular set of circumstances in front of you. And it's not the case that you have to be completely on your own in making those decisions. So there are different ways to interpret moral particularism, but one could be if it was coupled with some people call it virtue ethics, but the position we prefer, which is perhaps not quite the same, would be what we'd call dispositionalism. And this idea is that there are certain things that tend towards good outcomes. Telling the truth tends to be the right thing to do. It tends to produce good outcomes. But a tendency isn't absolute. There are always cases where it isn't going to be applicable. But what the rational moral agent does is understand the things that tend to produce good outcomes and have the judgment to know when to apply them. Now, the clinician, I think, is in a position where they can become a dispositionalist clinician. Don't you think, Connie, that would be a good term? Somebody who is in a position to make the judgments. I'm not going to give you any detail, but we've been talking over the last couple of days about the sorts of things that are needed that are going to put the clinician in a good position to make those judgments where they're not bound by the rules. Now, you might say, just to finish, you might say that maybe getting too concerned about this. So one thing we've heard when we've talked about this earlier is people say, well, guidelines are just guidelines. They're not absolute rules. And I'm comparing them to rule utilitarianism. They're not absolute rules. So let me just tell you, to finish, something that's counter to that, the things that I've seen over the last 2 days. So I was at lunch with somebody yesterday who said, if I ignore the guidance, I'm risking my career. Okay, so even if it is offered as guidance, somebody realises that all the risk comes on not following the guideline. If you follow the guideline, maybe you feel you're covered, but you're personally covered. If you don't follow the guideline, you're the one taking the risk. And the other thing I saw was the slide that Bill Fulford had earlier today, which was the preamble to the NICE guidelines. Now, I can't remember the exact wording, but if you just show me, is it up there? Right, yes, yeah, so it says, when exercising their judgment, professionals are expected to take this guideline fully into account. So that, it may seem that that's not intended as threatening words, but it clearly puts the onus on the clinician. The default position is follow the guideline. Meaning you've got to take it fully into account. You're going to have very good reasons not to follow the guideline. So there, that seems to me, can call it a guideline, but it seems to me it's got the force of a rule, and thus the objection to rule utilitarianism comes in. Whereas the dispositionalists might argue on the contrary that instead of having the rule and having to give reasons why you don't follow it, you could start with judgment as the default and then refer to rules when they're needed.